Welcome back. In this episode, I want to build a few more things. I want this spawn area to look very nice, and I really like this hole behind me, and so I wanted to make something with it. So let's start off this video with a quick build sequence. Alright, there we go. A nice bridge, walkway around the edge, a small pond and a fountain, as well as a road up to the market area. Also, I'm a lol noob is here again, and while I was decorating a bit, I suddenly started to hear music. Hopefully this doesn't get the video claimed, but damn, I'm jamming. Let's go. Okay, enough. Stop it. While I decorate the base a bit and collect some materials, I wanted to talk about code review versus dynamic testing. So when you as a hacker try to find vulnerabilities, you can try to do it blindly, just test the application, or maybe you have access to the source code and you read code instead. And so the question might be, which one is better? I love code reviews, and generally I think it's a waste of money and other resources when you don't have access to them. It's one major reason why I don't like to do bug bounty, because most of the targets are closed source. But code review is not always the silver bullet. I admit, sometimes dynamic testing is a lot easier because maybe the code is just awful or there is just too much of it. Using the application and looking for functionality to then specifically test might be a lot more useful. So for me, in my day-to-day job doing this professionally, I constantly flow between dynamic testing and code review and do whatever I feel like is the right choice at the moment. That's why I think it's so important for hackers to learn coding or at least learn to read code, because if you lack this tool, you might be left with very inefficient dynamic testing. Now, I wanted to briefly come back to something I did in a previous episode. Remember, I did dynamic testing to figure out how far away creepers get scared by cats? Well, let's see if we can find this in the code as well. In net Minecraft entity mob creeper entity, we can find the creeper class. It's very interesting to read the code here, but we are mostly interested in the AI of the mob. I'm looking at this code for the first time, but it seems the code is very self-explanatory. These goals seem to describe the goal of the mob, the behavior, the AI. So for example, with priority 1, the player is the active target, so the creeper attacks us. But there's also a visibility check for the player. Only if the creeper sees us, it will target us. And see this, with a slight lower priority of 3, the creeper will flee. It will flee from cats and ocelots. And the distance this happens at? 6 blocks. This is a really cool example for code review versus dynamic testing. Testing for the distance a creeper will flee from a cat is easy in Minecraft. You have to create a small test setup, but then it's easy to test. And that takes maybe around the same time it takes me to open up IntelliJ, pulling up the code and finding the right class and read the value here. However, we never talked about finding out what a creeper is scared about in the first place. Is a creeper even scared of anything? Well, maybe you would stumble over this behavior while playing, maybe you observed this in the wild, but if you didn't, it would be quite a lot of effort to figure out what kind of other entity, mob, or item makes a creeper scared. Looking at the code here, this is super simple, scared of cats and ocelots. But let me show you an example where I think dynamic testing is a lot more useful. We know mobs can die when falling down a large distance, but what's the limit? How far can they fall before they die? Maybe we want to know that so we can build a farm where we damage them just enough for a single punch. Well, this is of course answered in the code somewhere, but it's probably calculated. Over time, the falling speed is building up, so that influences how much damage they take. And then the next question, how much health does a creeper have anyway? Here's a handle fall damage function. It takes a fall distance, damage multiplier, and damage source. It calls compute fall damage in the superclass, which is fall distance -3 minus a status effect times the damage multiplier. This means we have to figure out where handle fall damage is even called, what is the damage multiplier, and how much health does a creeper have. You see, it gets a bit convoluted. Why not just go in a creative world and test it? Build a small test platform and let creepers fall down. It's a bit of a process too, but you will definitely find the answer. After some trial and error, the height is 24 blocks. Now they got max damage and die with a single punch. As you can see, to figure this out, the best strategy seems to be dynamic testing, just because I know I will easily get the answer this way. No need to struggle through the code. Cool, now we saw an example for both cases. I hope this shows you how important it is to choose the right strategy for whatever you want to figure out. And now let's use our code review skills a bit more. In Hermitcraft Season 9 Episode 2 by DocM77, he revealed a prank. Let me show you a clip from his video.
So, I actually pranked the whole server. So yeah, what happens if you put a turtle egg in any Minecraft world exactly at 000, any zombie in the world, not only, you know, around the player he is standing, globally, so any zombie that is loaded by any other hermit will start tracking towards this egg globally. Oh, here we go. Look at the zombies. Look at the Congo line back there. Zombie tracking ain't not working anymore. Country roads take me home to the place I belong. 00.
That is so weird. Turtle egg in 000 and zombies from everywhere start walking there. But why and how could you figure something out like this? Well, I'm 99.9% confident that this was not found accidentally in-game. Who would come up with testing that? But if you read the code around mob AI, it could be obvious. Check this out. Here's the zombie entity class and it has an AI goal to destroy any egg, specifically the turtle egg block. This inherits from the step and destroy block goal. So this seems to be generally AI code to take a step, so walk towards and destroy a target block. And here's that class. In the tick method, it always takes the mob position, but only does something if the mob reaches the target block, which means the AI to walk the egg is somewhere else. Probably in the other class it inherits from, move to target plus goal. In that tick function, if we found a target and this tick goal is executed, we would start moving towards that. So how do we even get a target block to walk towards? Where is target position set? Well, look here at the find target position function. Here it takes the current mob position and searches all blocks in an area around with some nested loops, and if a particular position is in walking range and at this position we have the target block, an egg, then we remember this position as the target position. But clearly, an egg at 000 would not be in range for a mob very far away, so this loop is probably not interesting for us. So where else is the target position set? And look at that. In the constructor, the target position is set to the origin block, the block position which x, y, and z values are all 0. Sounds suspicious, right? I think we are on the right track. Obviously, this is just meant as a temporary value, but this means the AI goal is always initialized to 000 by default. Let's go back down to the step and destroy block goal class. Here's a function that determines if this AI goal can start to be executed. And here we can see if the zombie has an available target, this AI goal can be started. When do we have an available target? If we have a target position set, which we have, it's never null, it's initialized with the origin, and then it checks this position with isTargetPos. This function takes the corresponding chunk of the world to check the target block, and if the block is the target block, so if it's a turtle egg, this will return true. So if a turtle egg happens to be at 000, then this check will always be true. The zombie has an available target. In the goal selector class, this is the class deciding which goals to execute, so basically decide the AI behavior of the zombie. Here it will now be able to start on the egg destroy goal, which makes the zombie move towards the egg on every tick. So yeah, if you read Minecraft code for fun, because maybe you want to optimize a zombie farm and you want to understand the zombie AI, you could stumble over this bug. Maybe you notice the target post can never be null, so that makes the behavior weird. And now understanding this code, we can also check if this applies to other mobs. Is there any other mob with a step and destroy block goal? Turns out no, the zombie is the only one that uses it. But there's also the more general class, move to target post goal. That one is used by a few other AI goal classes. While this class is kinda the root of the bug, it's initializing the target position to the origin, this canStart method is safe. It only returns true if findTargetPos is true, and that searches blocks nearby. So this AI generally doesn't trigger if the target block is not in range. The zombie bug only happens because step and destroy block goal overwrites the canStart method and changes that behavior. So let's see if other AI classes override the canStart method as well, and maybe they have a similar bug. Cat sit on block goal looks safe, it does call into the superclass canStart method, and same for go to bed and sleep goal. Fox eating berries goal also calls the superclass, all of them call the parent class canStart, which will check with find target post if the target block is within range. Looks like the bug only affects zombies. By the way, the server starts to see a bit more activity. I try to AFK sometimes to be able to record in case people join, and yeah, I was able to capture a few players spawning in my trap. They only can get out if they have a fly hack though, and turns out, of course, they do. To record the spawn area, I was also laying a bit further away behind the tree, and of course, players also found me there. But where is everybody? I was really hoping people would start expanding my base, building their own houses or whatever up there, but nothing, I'm still alone. Maybe they don't play on here and just join, or they go on their own adventure, which is of course also cool. Maybe in the future I could try to find their bases. I have access to the server, so we could try to find where they are at some point. Anyway, I want to build another farm as well, maybe a small bee farm. Candles and honey blocks would be cool, and I built it below the market. But it kinda looked like shit, so I decided to try to make like a flowery greenhouse kind of thing with lots of glass. So I had to gather some more sand and smelt it, and then just try to build one. By the way, this was not planned in creative before, this is me actually trying to make something in survival, but I don't know, it looked kinda bad. I also expanded the bee farm with a few more hives that I collected. By the way, the barrels on top are used to feed the farm with shears and bottles. I thought it could be nice once we expand the market up here, it looks very organic. Anyway, after the first iteration I decided to change a few things, remove the fence posts and replace it with strip wood logs and added a bit more supporting ceiling, and cool, bee farm done. So, see you next episode.